Good evening to everyone. Thank you very much for being here with us. This is the first of the many digital conversations to take place under the Greek chairmanship of the Council of Europe, which lasts until November. The Council of Europe, for those of you who may not or may not be familiar with it, is one of the most renowned supranational institutions in the world. It has been for many decades now a beacon of respect for defending rule, the rule of law, democracy, freedom of speech, and human rights. We are honored here today in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in this first digital conversation to have with us Dr. Sotiris Tsiodras, Professor of Medicine and Infectious Diseases at the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens, and of course the Chief Scientific Advisor for COVID-19 for the Greek government and the Greek CDC. I will now pass the floor for his introductory remarks. I will pass the digital floor to Mr. Miltiadis Varvitsiotis, the alternate Foreign Affairs Minister of Greece, who will also be chairing the Council of Europe Committee of Ministers for the next months.
Well, good evening, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here with you. You know that this chairmanship, the Greek chairmanship, is an e-chairmanship. We try to do all things digital because of the restrictions imposed by the COVID-19. In Greece, we have succeeded in flattening the curve, as was the original national goal. In order to succeed that, Dr. Sotiris Tsiodras undertook the responsibility of coordinating both the experts that took care of the measures, but also was the key person in informing the public and establishing with them a real relation of trust. We were amazed by his human approach to the challenges for this super difficult task, because putting people back in homes, restricting them from their fundamental freedoms, restricting them access to work, to joy, to help others, to education, to jurisdiction, was one very difficult task. In the framework of our chairmanship, we have put as main theme the COVID-19 implications in the rule of law, democracy, and the human rights. And we are trying to explore all the angles that contemplate with the pandemic and the restriction on the human rights, democracy, and the rule of law. We aim at the end of our chairmanship to have and to be able to present the guidelines of how the world and the democratic states of Europe should react in such cases. In this end, we have asked Professor Sotiris Tsiodras to join us today to open a series of discussions with well-known personalities, and by that also say him a big thank you for his contribution, for his wise ideas, and of course for his communication skills. Because for us, the Greeks, Sotiris Tsiodras, the last few months have become an icon of how to deal with difficult problems on a human way, respecting human life, dignity, and of course, liberty of each and everyone. Thank you very much for joining us in our first video conference, and I'll pass the floor to our main guests.
Thank you very much, Minister Varvitsiotis, for this, and I will pass right away the digital floor to Professor Sotiris Tsiodras for your very interesting presentation.
Good evening, everybody. I would like to thank the minister for the nice words he said about me. I wish him good luck at presiding the European Council, the Council of Europe, and this chairmanship. I wish has a lot of fruit with regards to the ideas he spoke about during his introduction. I decided to talk to you about patient safety, a very important issue, and we based our patient safety strategy during the response to the COVID-19 related pandemic caused by the SARS-CoV-2 virus on a WHO issued checklist that was published on April 2020. Next slide, please. This list has some very important patient safety related issues. I'm going to start with surge capacity issues. And basically, by surge capacity, we mean the ability of a hospital to expand beyond its normal capacity and to meet an increased demand for clinical and critical care. And starting from the National Pandemic Plan that was revised late January 2020, before the end of January, 1 month before our first case was introduced in Greece by a decision by the Minister of Health, Vasilis Kikilias, we had 13 dedicated COVID-19 hospitals appointed by the ministry. Each of them was representing a major prefecture in the country. Eventually, as you can see at the bottom of the slide, many more hospitals took care of patients suffering from the disease. We started with multiple exercises and simulations across hospitals. In one of the simulations, the director of the Greek CDC was actually pretending to be a COVID-19 patient. And when we talk about exercises, we emphasize operational infection prevention and control programs and a triage procedure that's very important in accepting patients in the hospital. And a good triage basically is very, very important to prevent spread in healthcare workers. And as you can see, very early in February 2020, we had those exercises performed in several prefectures across the country. Next slide. Of course, when you talk about staff capacity, you mean about trained staff and staff that was exposed to a very important factor, the fear factor, as I call it, to deal with this unknown virus. And there were a lot of unknowns early in the course of this disease that we heard about from China. And there was a big effort by the Ministry of Health to increase the staff numbers by several thousands, including MDs, registered nurses, and other supportive personnel in the hospital. And it was very, very important to ensure that some of these appointments would be turned and switched to permanent appointments, especially for temporary registered nurses and MDs. And of course, the very important thing that works really well in those kind of situations to have a very strong primary care COVID network. This was one of the important issues in this in facing this pandemic, but we started with the COVID hospitals, and then we put our emphasis on supporting primary care centers in order to participate in this triage process and this referral to the hospital system.
So, Professor, all these people, they're not only COVID-19 dedicated medical and staff, they're also doctors who are in general for the Greek national healthcare system.
They're doctors for the Greek national healthcare system, and some of them, of course, supported the primary COVID-19 hospital network. There was a big issue that was faced by all the countries, personal protective equipment, as it was called by CNN, the war of the masks. And there was a big urgent need to increase our stockpile for masks, for gowns, for gloves, for goggles, for head coverings, and a strict demand management system was put in place in order to procure this equipment. There was no stop over special flights to procure personal protective equipment, and we faced a huge increase in prices. The prices quadrupled or even went as high as five times more for essential protective equipment for healthcare workers. And solidarity amongst nations was a big issue. And we heard about stories where an airplane went to pick up a huge procurement, and this was already taken by another country. Next slide. Of course, healthcare worker safety was a very, very paramount issue, and FFP2's high efficacy masks versus FFP3's masks had to be prioritized for people involved in the front lines, people, especially for FFP3s, that at some point became unavailable worldwide.
Because several people may not be acquainted with terms still. Can you see the difference between FFP2 and FFP3?
Yeah, FFP3 is the top notch that you have to use in what we call an AGP, an aerosol generating procedure. Basically, people being hospitalized in the intensive care unit where you have to suction secretions from the trachea, from the deep portion of the lung. And FFP2s are a little bit less protective, but still offer enough protection to deal with these patients. And many times I examine patients at this point of circulation of the virus in our country, in our hospitals, using an FFP2. FFP3s were only used for people that underwent AGPs and were in the intensive care unit. And those procedures like bronchoscopy, where you see inside the bronchi and they generate a big amount of aerosols. And people used other techniques as well, like face shields and special protection measures for these kind of situations, like special tubes. And we use 3D printing in our country to produce face shields for this kind of shortages. Thank God we didn't face any shortages, and a very, very small percentage of our healthcare workers became affected by the virus. Overall, it was 0.2%. Of course, when one examines the entire amount of positive cases in the country, you'll see that a big portion, almost 10%, was healthcare workers or people working in the hospital. And of course, the mental issue and the financial support issue of these people working in the front lines was raised, and they were supported as much as possible by the Ministry of Health. And there was a pilot program assessing mental needs of healthcare workers. Interestingly enough, when one sees the statistics and some of the trials, since they were prepared, they didn't face the panic that that people in the lay public faced with this virus. As far as ICU beds, we created a dual capacity system and dedicated the COVID ICUs expanded in number, and there was a converting process from beds that were used by other units like cardiothoracic surgery units or other units that were tertiary care units. And as you can see, there was an increase of the ICU bed capacity by the Ministry of Health by an average of close to five ICU beds per 100,000 population. To more than nine, and there's a plan to converting more and creating more ICU beds by the end of the year. There we converted step-down units to be used as ICU beds. Infectious disease units, some of the beds there were used as ICU beds because some people were really sick and severe, and there was a problem with transferring them. Next slide. And as you can see, due to the strict lockdown effectiveness, we used only 2.6 per 100,000 population ICU beds during the response to this pandemic. The target by the end of this year is to increase our intensive care unit bed capacity and go very, very close to the European mean.
There were also some private donations for building up the ICU capacity in Greece.
Yes, it was very important. As you can see in the bottom right corner of this slide, this is from May 2020. From a donation, several beds to a hospital in Thessaloniki. And this was very important that people came out and assisted the government and donated big amounts of money to support the healthcare and the health system in Greece. Next slide. And as you can see, ICU care, this is the epidemic of ICU hospitalized patients that went down with the effectiveness of the measures. Next slide. This was data from the Greek Centers for Disease Control, we call it now, National Organization of Public Health. The testing was a big issue, and it's still a big issue with regards to the response to this virus. Testing capacity, as you can see, increased from several hundreds a day up to the capacity of 10,000 per day. The mean average of tests has substantially increased over the course of the last couple of months. In the beginning, there were lots of technical difficulties with primers, with methods, with laboratory technical issues. Some of those were published this month by Greek colleagues and European colleagues from Germany in a big American journal called Emerging Infectious Disease. And I remember a point where there was a big lack of reagents across Europe, and this was a major issue that we had to face. And we did what the European CDC suggested at this time point. We prioritized testing according to their guidance. The European Centers for Disease Control has issued guidance, and several other countries followed our example for people that belong to what we call high-risk groups, people working in the front lines, people suffering from severe disease, healthcare workers, and this was very important.
So it was targeted testing.
It was targeted testing.
It still is.
No, we changed that, and we adapted new guidance for testing. Now that we have more testing, we offer testing to people that have symptoms, independent of whether they belong to a high-risk category or not. And we expanded the testing guidance to include people that belong to a cluster of people affected by the virus. So you test the cluster as well, especially in people that belong to vulnerable groups like Roma or migrants. Yeah. Next slide. So this is exactly what you asked about, the broader testing criteria that we adopted as a scientific committee of 26 scientists, epidemiologists, laboratory clinicians, and infectious disease specialists, intensive care unit specialists. And you can see outbreak responses of essence right now. In order to face and respond to any cluster of infection, so we don't get to see it spreading in the community. And this will be assisted greatly by a huge program incorporated by the National Public Health Organization that entails a daily operation of what we call mobile units that cover the entire country, even islands, and go there and perform testing.
So this is right now we have this the kind of capacity up to 500 mobile units.
Well, it's supposed to reach the 500 target by the end of the summer. And it's very, very important in responding to outbreaks in local situations. And it will help us tremendously, I believe, with tourism and the opening of tourism in our country. Another thing about testing that people don't talk about, but there was a lot of strict criteria for efficacy and what we call sensitivity and specificity of a test, is antibodies. And antibodies is what our antibody, or what our organism creates as an antidote for the virus. And there's special tests that we call antibody tests that people know from other diseases like hepatitis or HIV, and can tell you whether you had hepatitis, for example. And now the scientific community is trying to establish those antibody titers as a means of saying whether you had the disease in the past. There's some technical issues with it, and there's guidance from the European Centers for Disease Control and WHO to use them for seroepidemiological studies, meaning studies that will go into a population and examine a sample of this population and tell you whether this person had the disease or not. We started with two special populations. One was the blood donor population from the National Institute of Blood Donation. And we found in preliminary tests with over 3,000 people tested, blood donors, that 0.7% had a positive test, and we plan to expand this to 10,000 people tested to reach a definitive number. And we used it in a remnant sera from people going to the hospital for any reason, and we find a 0.35%, so much lower than 1% of the Greek population is estimated to be affected. We plan a national seroepidemiological study to further confirm this, and we believe this was part of the effectiveness of our measures.
This study is something imminent that's going to take place.
Yes, yes.
The next few weeks or something.
Yes, it will take place the next few weeks, and has been designed with the assistance of the National Kapodistrian University of Athens Medical School Epidemiology Unit, and it will be organized implemented by the National Public Health Organization. So, by our mathematical models were telling us, by the surveillance of the hospitalized patients, the ICU patients, and the deaths, that we had less than 1% of the population affected. And this is verified now by the seroepidemiological studies. Next slide. Of course, therapy. It's a big issue, and as you well know, there was no approved therapy when this all started, and they were talking about therapies potentially effective against the virus, like chloroquine and the combination of chloroquine and azithromycin from a French group, and some other combinations including anti-HIV medication, and other medications like ones that have been tried in the past against Ebola, and were found in the lab to work against this virus. So there was a big thing about who to treat, and across countries there was a decision by scientific bodies to focus our therapy on moderate to severely diseased patients. Some countries elected to treat these patients by including them only in clinical trials. Some countries elected to give them whatever was supposedly effective at this point, and then add any new therapy as an add-on therapy. And for some protocols, it was not allowed, like the protocol for the Ebola effective drug, the remdesivir drug, and you had to give them just that. And we moved across a very, very thin line in order to decide what to give our patients, moderately to severely patients, and again, give access to therapy to everybody that needed it, especially the high-risk group patients.
Is it like more like a comfort therapy, or is it an actual therapy that you could cure the...
Well, nobody knows until you have the results of what we call a randomized clinical trial, a trial that gives half of the people placebo, essentially no drug, but a pill that looks like the drug you're receiving, or a vial that's given intravenously that looks like the drug you're receiving, and the other half receives the therapy. And people have what we call adapted designs that could give you four or five different regimens. And one was taking so-and-so regimen, the other one was taking the Ebola drug, the other one was taking the combination drug, and the other one was taking the placebo, in order to assure that a vast majority of patients were receiving something potentially effective, but potentially toxic as well. Next slide. And as you can see here, this was part of our list. We gave hydroxychloroquine or chloroquine with or minus azithromycin. That was included in our scientific guidance. Remdesivir we gave as a part of what we call an expanded access program initially, then a clinical trial program, and now what we call an early access program, where several hospitals participate. And I'm hearing that the European Union, the medicinal agency of the European Union, is going to fast track this drug in order for people to have it. This drug was shown to be approximately 60% effective, successful in severely ill patients. So we don't know what its effect will be in someone who has mild to moderate severe disease. And this is part of the problem when you face a new virus, a new pandemic, where there's no established therapy. And at the same time, a protocol was published for the combination of the anti-HIV drug lopinavir-ritonavir with ribavirin, a well-known antiviral agent, but with some toxicities, and interferon, which is a part of the normal response of our body to viruses. So this combined regimen is now part of a new guidance that was issued in Greece last week, and can be given to patients along with remdesivir if they can have it. And we continue with the guidance for hydroxychloroquine. You might have heard about
There's been a big debate,
yeah.
Yeah,
the
everyone
big debate,
has heard about it.
The big debate about...
In Europe and the US as well.
Yes, and some countries actually banned the use of chloroquine in their patient populations because they said we need to see the randomized clinical trial, placebo versus drug trial. We saw some data from the initial group by Professor Didier Raoul that went up to thousands of patients with very good results, and we decided to keep it for the moment. We didn't have any signal for toxicity in our patient population, but I remind you, our patient population received it in the hospital in a very, very closely observed environment, and we want to analyze our data as well to have some more evidence about it. Where colchicine was a part of a big trial in Greece, the GRECO trial by cardiologists, very interesting, because colchicine has a cardioprotective effect. And friends from the university, it's a very cheap drug. Its only side effect is diarrhea, have used it in more than 100 patients and have some good initial data, preliminary data, and we'll see how this very cheap, easy to use drug may help in the future management of this disease. Another big thing was immune modulation, because as you well know, part of the importance of this virus was the severe manifestations that usually showed a few days after the initial attack of the virus. 5 to 7 days, people would develop this huge inflammatory reaction. We will be talking like we talk now, and in a couple of hours, I will be intubated. So that was part of the virus attacking my lungs and giving me no reserve that would follow precipitously. It was very important. People were talking about using a pulse oximeter to monitor your oxygen, and we faced it in the hospital. So in this part of the inflammatory reaction, no antiviral would be successful. The one thing that would be successful would be anti-inflammatory medication, like anti-interleukin-6 was one of the inflammatory cytokines that our body was producing. And we believe that this was part of the reaction of the organism against the virus that was harmful. And they call it a cytokine storm. And another big Greek group was a pioneer from our hospital in this in similar studies together with people from.
As I can see, this was the only one that had a harmful side effect. Well, vis-a-vis the others.
Well, this one can have other harmful side effects. It can create what we call the potential of being attacked by other bacteria. So it suppresses the inflammatory reaction, which is part of your body's response to the virus, but at the same time can give you susceptibility to other bacteria. So it's a sort of you're walking on the edge, as we said. And of course, you've heard about convalescent plasma, which is plasma from donors that suffer from the disease, and you take it from a special procedure. And a big study by the University of Athens is being coordinated for giving plasma, and I believe more than, I think, 6 or 7 people have got it so far. And we had some encouraging results from abroad last week, and we're following the convalescent plasma pathway of therapy. It's a cheap therapy. You use the people who pass the disease, and they give you their plasma, and you give it in 3 successful donations. They every other day, and you
so
follow.
You see that there are preliminary results that gives us some ground to be hopeful for.
From abroad, okay. Not yet from Greece, but it's really early because very few people have got this convalescent plasma from donors in Greece, and of course other trials. Next slide. You see, it's very important to have stockpiles of medicine when you deal with this thing. There was a procurement of chloroquine early enough from with the first data, the early data, and of course there's this early access program that I talked about, and of course regulation is very important. The regulatory process in times of uncertainty, and all this happened through the National Medicinal Organization, and was facilitated greatly by the director of the National Medicinal Organization, Dr. Philippou. Next slide. And of course, pharmacovigilance, an area where there's lots of under-reporting, especially in times of crisis, and you have to follow several issues. We had very, very few reports of side effects associated with the drugs that we gave to patients. And this was reassuring for us, but I think as Europe and as countries facing the pandemic and seeing the pandemic as an opportunity to improve in some areas, pharmacovigilance is one of these very important issues, as well as follow-up of patients, especially patients like the elderly, where there's a polypharmacy issue. They take several other medications together with the medication against the virus. And this, I think, European efforts are very important in this regard. Next slide. Of course, multiple targets, unknown effect, ethical dilemmas of placebo trials when you face something that's potentially lethal and could kill you. And this is a very, very important work that we published with French and German colleagues together with people working in my hospital, and shows you the potential of collaboration during these times of crisis. Next slide. And the issue of trials that we talked about, and this is a big trial that we participate as a country that has four arms, and the fifth arm is a placebo arm. And this is the study where they dropped they stopped it, they paused it to evaluate the results from the chloroquine arm to be sure that it's not harmful.
So this is ongoing, what we're seeing right
yes,
now?
Yes, this is ongoing. Next slide. And of course, the big issue about vaccines, the joint procurement, the patent issue, and whether we're going to have a patent, a no-patent vaccine that can be distributed to all the countries around the world. The conspiracy theories that the vaccine will be used in some way to track you or track your movement.
But this is not something new, meaning this has been as long as vaccines are around. These conspiracy theories are around as well.
Yes, the anti-vax movement, unfortunately, has deprived people of life-saving and life-sustaining vaccines like the measles vaccine. And we saw a couple of years ago in Europe a huge outbreak of measles that costed human lives. And only by the measles vaccine, more than 10 million people have 10 million lives have been saved over the last several years. Next slide. And of course, this is the landscape of the vaccines. 10 are in clinical trials right now, phase one or phase two. Some of them are in phase two trials. Phase two is one of the where you start talking about the phase three, which is the late stage before approval. And I saw encouraging messages from China yesterday about one of their vaccines. And 121 vaccine trials are right now going in at the preclinical mode, where you test them in rats and monkeys and chimpanzees and other animal experiments. But you can see that there's a strong effort, and this strong effort is very reassuring, because it's doubtful that one vaccine from one company will suffice for the entire world population. We will need more than one vaccine. And
so there's a glimmer of hope here, meaning producing a vaccine in the near future. I don't know how near this future is.
Yeah, but it's going to be only a few million doses. The near future, the best that we can hope for is end of this year, a few million doses, but a few million doses here and there. And if it's a safe and effective vaccine, this is the most important thing. And we don't want to hasten the procedure. We don't want to be extremely fast. We want to be fast, but we want to assure that the safety is there and the efficacy is there. And as you can see here, the big issue is whether it will be widely accepted. And we faced a huge fiasco in 2009, across the world. There was this new pandemic vaccine for influenza. It was a pandemic strain. It was not very lethal, but people estimate that several hundreds of thousands of people died, and some say more than a million. And the vaccine was not accepted. Over the entire vaccine campaign that was made by the WHO, 300 million people around the world got vaccinated. So you can imagine what that meant for the vaccine, and the pandemic virus continued to circulate. And in our country, 3% of the population got vaccinated. Next slide. And you can see here what the minister talked about in the beginning, flattening the curve. This is data from our country in the National Public Health Organization. We were successful in flattening the curve. This was very important in our country. Next slide. And this is the effect of the measures. This is a publication by Professor Vanasipsa, a group that examined contacts between people during the lockdown period. And you can see that the lockdown was 80% effective in decreasing contacts. And this is essentially the epidemic in
decreasing the spread, you mean?
Yes, decreasing spread. And this is, you see here, the curve of the epidemic in our country, which is very important, and the famous effective R, which is the number that people and countries use, together with the ICU bed capacity, the hospital bed capacity, the number of the positive cases, in order to assess the progress of the epidemic and whether they need to do something more. And the R, the effective R in our country yesterday evening was 0.31. Next slide. And of course, communication issues. It's very, very tough to communicate uncertainty, especially when you deal with discrimination, stigma, solidarity issues, the front lines, and whether you can do it at the same time and be there with the Roma people in Larissa, and at the same evening be with the civil protection minister, Mr. Kardalias, at the
I remember then in Larissa the people were listening to you very carefully. They were waiting for you, like they were making space for you to join them and listen to what they were listening to, what you have to say.
Yeah, it was very important that we went there, I think, and it was, gave them the notion that we're there with them and we're not something different. We're all human beings, and solidarity is a big issue that you need to keep in mind. Next slide. You can't use them as scapegoats, for sure. And those are the people I'm talking about, the people that are tough to address, the migrants, the Roma, the homeless. The emphasis on the protection of high-risk population to deal with small local outbreaks like the one in Larissa or in Kranidi. The tough issues faced, mass testing, of course, voluntary, according to their free will participation, and to persuade them, to convince them that this is for the good of the community. The quarantine facility for mild cases that were in these areas of hospitality, the use of mediators, the facilitation by NGOs, and of course, the to face the stigma. And of course, I believe there we need further multidisciplinary work, and I believe this is very necessary for the future. And the mobile Greek CDC unit, the National Public Health Organization unit, was of enormous help there. And this is from the Nigeria refugee community in Kranidi outbreak. Next slide. Of course, there's several other sectors that have not been evaluated yet, like access to care, balance issues, chronic disease issues, and whether there was a lag in meeting appointments and medical appointments, ER visits. There was a huge decrease in some of the incidences of life-threatening situations like myocardial infarctions, and we don't know the exact reason behind that. This was observed in other countries as well. Of course, we never stopped oncology surgery during the epidemic. Some essential services had to be continued, and of course there was a lockdown and the fear of people that essentially brought us fear about missing essential diseases like stroke, or special announcements by the Greek Neurological Society to recognize signs of stroke, and there was a big discussion about association of the new disease with stroke and other side effects, multi-systemic disease.
But nothing has been proven on that front.
Nothing has been proven, but it was important not to miss them during the epidemic. And of course, the huge issue of mental issues and projects with regards to that relating to healthcare workers and the general public. And of course, the preparation for the question of a second wave and improving healthcare provision and patient safety. We need to maintain a full and functional medical COVID-19 patient-related registry.
Is there maybe a word potential missing from there, like for a potential second wave, or are we sure that it's going to be a second wave?
Well, you've heard a lot about it by WHO and the European CDC, and everybody feels confident that this will come back. Coronavirus are a strange type of viruses. And in the past, they have shown that a stabilization circulation and the potential of causing regular seasonal outbreaks of common cold. We hope that it will evolve to be something like that, and with the potential of the vaccine, we will suppress it. Of course, improve hospital indices in the patient regarding patient safety issues, like a big issue in the Greek hospital system is multi-drug resistant organisms. Of course, nurse to patient ratio, and a quality control, quality assurance, maintenance of certification that are very, very difficult to address. And of course, primary health care for distant and non-urban areas. There was, at the midst of the pandemic, they appointed some primary care COVID healthcare facilities in urban areas like Athens to support and decompress the pressure to the hospital. And we need to see a very, very functional primary healthcare network operating in the country that will not be afraid to face such issues. There was lots of support from a primary healthcare network, but we need more support. Next. And of course, there's right now an immediate plan by the Ministry of Health to create and legislate a quality assurance and patient safety agency within the Ministry of Health that will focus on quality improvement, has specific indicators that will be used to evaluate the system. And we need to harmonize such protocols across countries in the European Union through a cross-border collaboration, especially with neighboring countries that will share protocols regarding patient safety and patient-related research at the bedside. So next slide. And of course, this was all a very, very strong political commitment behind this teamwork. And I need to acknowledge some of the people, like the ministers and the alternate minister of health, the general secretaries of health, and of course, a wonderful committee of scientists, the National Public Health Organization, and several other multiple people from everywhere in the country came aboard to help us, volunteers, the private sector. And I think what we accomplished as a country, besides the strong political commitment and the government commitment, was the commitment from the people that were with us in all this big effort. And with this, I would like to finish my talk. I'd like to thank you for your attention. And
thank you very much. We're already 45 minutes into this conversation, and I know that your group of experts is still meeting right now and working every day. But since we have a pan-European audience, one last before we close this event, this digital event, if you have like a message to convey to European people as a whole, this is the 1st of June, summer starts, we're already 4 months into this pandemic. If you would like to address European citizens and send them a message.
Yes, I would like to say that solidarity is the big message. I would like to say no to fear and panic, yes to solidarity, no to stigma. We're all in this together, and we will fight this and we'll prevail.
So, Professor Tsiodras, thank you very much. We also thank our hosts here, the Greek Minister of Foreign Affairs, and we wish them the best in their chairmanship of the Council of Europe, which was started in May and will be here until November, with many more digital conversations such as this one we had today. Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you.